Welcome back to Axel for March 2015. I'm Alfred Beauvais. Disc 3 begins with a discussion Dolph Hutter had with Dr. Gregory Lewis, assistant professor of medicine at Harvard and director of the cardiopulmonary exercise lab at the Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston. They cover approach to pulmonary hypertension and left heart disease, practical approaches to management of pulmonary hypertension.
Greg, welcome to Axel.
Thank you, Dolph. I'm happy to be here.
Greg, could you just briefly define the difference between the groups of pulmonary artery hypertension?
Yes. Group 1, pulmonary hypertension, in simplistic terms, is a direct insult to the pulmonary vasculature, whereas group 2, pulmonary hypertension, is in left heart disease as the primary mediator. Group 3 is when there's lung disease. Group 4, thromboembolic disease. Group 5 is other miscellaneous etiologies. So the group 1 is where we've learned a lot about pulmonary arterial hypertension, though that is a small minority of patients compared to the much more prevalent group 2 pulmonary hypertension.
And when we use the word pulmonary hypertension, that's in a difference to pulmonary arterial hypertension. What's the difference?
Correct. Pulmonary hypertension refers to all patients that have mean pulmonary arterial pressures in excess of 25 millimeters of mercury. The pulmonary arterial hypertension patients have a predominant precapillary contribution to their pulmonary hypertension, whereas pulmonary hypertension itself is all comers that have elevation in their pulmonary pressures.
So I have a patient now, and he's got pulmonary hypertension. And this is mostly from an echo now, I guess, because very few of us know how to make that a diagnosis on physical examination. What do I do next? What's the workup for a person with a high pulmonary artery blood pressure?
The echo often is the first step in the evaluation of these patients, and there is elevation in the right ventricular systolic pressure. It's important to look at other clues from the echocardiogram. For example, how much dysfunction of the right ventricle is there? Is the right ventricle dilated? Is it hypokinetic? Are there signs of significant left heart disease that would be the number one likely etiology of the high pressures, whether it be a valvular heart disease, left ventricular systolic dysfunction, thick walls with left atrial enlargement as a clue to pulmonary hypertension arising from diastolic dysfunction, for example. So the echocardiogram can be helpful in that regard, whereas if it's more of a precapillary pulmonary hypertension, one might see a predominance of left heart normality and right ventricular dysfunction with a shift in the septum towards the left side, for example, dilation of the pulmonary artery. So the echocardiogram should be reviewed carefully as a first step in looking at patients that have elevations in their pressures.
So the next step, I guess, once you have that, is to work up the cause of the left heart failure and fix anything you can fix. Valvular heart disease, treat systemic hypertension, and use of diuretics, I would assume. Is that fair?
It is. And one of the things that we found to be very interesting is that even after addressing the left heart dysfunction, there's a significant subgroup of patients that have elevations in the pulmonary arterial pressures that are out of proportion to the degree of left heart disease that is observed. And when we see that, it is an important and potent prognostic indicator in that these high pulmonary pressures out of proportion to the degree of left heart disease predict poor prognosis in patients with left heart disease.
Do you need a cath to do that? You need a right heart cath to do that?
The right heart cath really is the gold standard in a patient that is suspected of having pulmonary hypertension in this out of proportion range in order to carefully evaluate the precapillary and postcapillary contributions to the pulmonary hypertension as best measured by the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and the transpulmonary gradient, which is the mean pulmonary arterial pressure minus the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. Recently, there's also been an interest in looking specifically at the gradient between the diastolic pulmonary arterial pressure and the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, and that diastolic gradient in excess of 7 millimeters of mercury has been linked to poor outcomes and histological evidence of adverse remodeling of the pulmonary vasculature itself in patients with left heart disease.
And what are the other clues that the pulmonary blood pressure is out of proportion?
So that's where the use of the measured transpulmonary gradient by invasive right heart catheterization, as well as the pulmonary vascular resistance, because I feel that it's important to account for how much flow is going through the pulmonary circulation. So a pulmonary vascular resistance that's in excess of 3 Wood units, for example, offers a clue that this patient has a significant, what we call precapillary burden of pulmonary hypertension.
And the transpulmonary gradient, is there a number for that?
In excess of 15 has been used, although that is very flow dependent. So if somebody that has a higher cardiac output, you're going to see higher transpulmonary gradient. That's why I think that the pulmonary vascular resistance remains a gold standard indicator of precapillary pulmonary vascular.
So that's
burden.
The number one clue.
Correct. And that's obviously invasively measured.
Now, you made the diagnosis. It's out of proportion. You're in the cath lab. Do you do any diagnostic or therapeutic efforts in the
If the diagnosis is obvious, for example, there's a significant elevation in left-sided filling pressures and a relatively modest elevation transpulmonary gradient, there is not additional maneuvers that are necessary. What we're often faced with is a patient that has dyspnea with exertion and a similar degree of elevation in the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and transpulmonary gradient, for example. And in those patients, I find that provocative maneuvers are very helpful. For example, if a pulmonary vasodilator is given and it significantly reduces the precapillary component of pulmonary hypertension, that's a clue that it's significant. If saline exposure unmasks significant diastolic dysfunction with a acute elevation in the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, that helps to rule in the diagnosis of diastolic dysfunction as a predominant contributor. And then finally, exercise can be extremely useful in teasing apart the relative contributions of the pre- and post-capillary pulmonary hypertension during the highly relevant exposure of exercise, which is when most of these patients become symptomatic.
I assume if I sent a patient to you and he did have some congestive heart failure, you would like to see him about as dry as I can get him. Is that fair?
Absolutely. In fact, it's been looked at in a retrospective analysis of the VMAC trial in which the prognostic significance of the pulmonary hypertension really only comes out after one has optimized the left-sided filling pressures with appropriate diuretics, vasodilator therapy. So attention should first be directed to the left heart disease, as you said.
Now, let's go into management of this out-of-proportion pulmonary hypertension. What agents do we have? How do you decide which one to use?
It's a very important question because we know that this out-of-proportion pulmonary hypertension is very important prognostically. We don't have large randomized outcomes trials to tell us what the answer is. We do have small studies with agents that augment nitric oxide cyclic GMP signaling. For example, the phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors have been studied in small trials in patients with left ventricular systolic dysfunction and pulmonary hypertension and shown to improve exercise capacity and hemodynamic measurements. In diastolic heart failure, there's been 2 recent studies. The RELAX trial was negative, which was all comers with heart failure preserved ejection fraction. However, a second smaller study by Guazzi and colleagues in patients that had heart failure with preserved ejection fraction and significant right ventricular dysfunction and precapillary pulmonary hypertension, those patients had dramatic improvements in their hemodynamics.
Therefore, sildenafil works best in those who have right ventricular dysfunction.
Absolutely. Okay.
What about the role of calcium channel blockers?
Calcium channel blockers have been studied primarily in WHO group 1 pulmonary hypertension that's shown to be reactive to inhaled nitric oxide or other pulmonary vasodilators. There's really not a role in patients that have significant left ventricular systolic dysfunction, for example, in that we know that there's deleterious effects of calcium channel blockers potentially on LV performance.
And Greg, we don't have time. I know there are other drugs being investigated, but those are the mainstays right now. Is that fair?
I'd also like to add other drugs that have been investigated in other forms of pulmonary arterial hypertension. For example, soluble guanylate cyclase inhibitors such as riociguat that has recently been approved for WHO group 1 and 4 pulmonary hypertension has been investigated in patients that have left heart dysfunction and shown to improve cardiac output, though primary endpoint of change in pulmonary arterial pressure was not met. That was the LEFT trial published in 2013.
Greg, thank you very much. That's an excellent summary of a complicated problem.
Thank you, Dolph.